I'd like to move into our presentation for today, Cold War at Sea. Lieutenant Commander Lund is a 1954 graduate of Lexington High School. He earned a baccalaureate degree from the Tufts University and an MBA from Northeastern University. He was commissioned as an ensign in the United States Naval Reserve in 1954 or 59, and served for 3 years aboard the destroyer escort radar picket ship. He also commanded 3 different mine sweepers. So, let me welcome Peter Lund.
Thank you very much for that very kind introduction. I'm quite honored to be your speaker here today, because I gather that this is probably the 200th program of the group. Pretty neat. Very much appreciate the opportunity. Quick question, how many Navy guys? Aha, that's good. So for the rest of you, if I get going too much with the Navy jargon, port, starboard, you know, fore, aft, fantail, quarterdeck, just feel free to interrupt me or just ask one of these other fellows that happen to serve in the United States Navy. I may digress into a few, shall we say, tangential sea stories. So if I steer too much off course, I'd appreciate your letting me know, and we'll see if we can get back on the straight and narrow. I'm also prone to interject some facts about the Navy, which don't necessarily bear on this particular presentation. A quickie in that line, World War II. For every regular naval officer, and we would define a regular naval officer as one who had graduated from the Naval Academy, right? There were 77 reserve officers. Quite a ratio. So you'll probably hear me more than once emphasize my experience as an officer in the United States Naval Reserve. Very proud of that fact. Let me set the stage with some key hostile events from the end of World War II to the early 60s. That's sort of part one. Part two, let me share with you my experiences on the Dew Line and some other assignments on the Calcaterra. And then we'll spend a moment or two on mine warfare 101, just a little bit of the fundamentals of mine warfare. Second digression. The year 2012 for the United States Navy is a rather historic one in naval annals. And we all know that the attack on Pearl Harbor happened 70 years ago last December. Well, Yamamoto was supposedly said when they were departing the environs of Pearl, saying, "I fear we have done nothing more than awaken a sleeping giant." So let me tell you about that sleeping giant as a brief digression during 70 years ago in 1942. In April of 42, Jimmy Doolittle and his B-25s attacked the Japanese homeland, okay? And they flew from the USS Hornet, and there were 16 B-25s, and the Hornet, unfortunately, was sunk at the Battle of Santa Cruz in October of that same year. In May of 1942 was the Battle of the Coral Sea, and that's when the Lady Lex was sunk. And she was, what, number 5? Or number 4 of all the ships that have carried the name USS Lexington. Now, the significance of that particular battle was it was the first fleet action where the combatants never saw one another. It was aircraft and aircraft carriers, and they duked it out. Now, the battle probably came off as a draw. Ashley and I, with another bunch of folks, were in Spain some years ago, and I was sitting at the bar next to an Australian, and I was recounting my experience of having sailed up the Potomac River to Washington, D.C. to help the Australian embassy celebrate the battle of the victory of the Coral Sea. And this Aussie turned to me and he said, "You know, if it weren't for you Yanks, we'd be eating with chopsticks." In June of 42, it was the Battle of Midway, and the U.S. Navy sunk the last of Japan's 3 carriers. In October of 42 was the Battle of Leyte Gulf. And let me touch on a little engagement off the peninsula of Samar. And there was a DE involved there by the name of the Samuel B. Roberts, and she was sunk. But I'll come back to that as we get further into this presentation. So if you would, just remember that name, the Samuel B. Roberts, affectionately known as the Sammy B. So in less than a year, we effectively had neutralized the Japanese fleet. So when you talk about the sleeping giant being awakened, I think we awakened rather quickly and rather effectively. Post-World War II, interesting times through the 40s and the 50s. Harking back, VE Day was the 8th of May, 1945, and VJ Day was August 14th of that same year. March 5 of 1946, which is less than a year later, Winston Churchill was at Westminster College in Fulton, Missouri, to receive an honorary degree. And at that time, he was introduced by no other than President Harry S. Truman. And it was at that particular university and the particular speech where Churchill said, "The Iron Curtain has descended." June of 48 to May of 49 was the Berlin blockade by the Russians, and the subsequent airlift, which was at its height on the 16th of April in 49. And on that particular day, Allied aircraft were landing every minute in Berlin, and they were being unloaded by German crews in about 20 to 30 minutes. Formidable effort. 46 to 47, the Truman Doctrine saved Greece from the communists. Maybe we need to save them again. Summer of 1950, the North Koreans attacked the South, and that lasted until the Eisenhower administration in 1953. My parents immigrated from Denmark in the 1920s, and my parents went back in 1935, and my mother had not been back since then. So we sailed a vessel, the USS Batory, to Copenhagen to spend the summer, at that summer of 1950, in Denmark. The Korean War broke out the day we landed in Copenhagen, so my mother was like this for the whole trip. I'm sure it was not quite as enjoyable as she had hoped it would be. 1955 was the Hungarian uprising, and it was squelched by the Russians. And if you have a chance to go to Liberty Square in Boston, you'll find that there's a memorial to that particular event right there in Liberty Square. May of 54, the Viet Minh defeated the French at Dien Bien Phu. So Southeast Asia had effectively fallen to the communists. 1949 was the Chinese Civil War ended, and Chiang Kai-shek hightails it for Taiwan, and Mao Zedong takes over on the mainland. 56, we had a little crisis in the Suez, and Nasser wanted the canal to be under Egyptian control, total Egyptian control. Great Britain and France said, uh-uh, and they were joined by Israel. And finally, the UN did mediate that situation, and all vessels were allowed to freely transit the Suez. 1961, the Berlin Wall went up. So, a little bit of history over here. Here I am, undergraduate at Tufts.
Down?
Say again?
Was that down? I thought the wall
No, it went up.
The wall went up.
Went up, 61. I think it was 61. In fact, we were on I was on active duty when it went up. So here I am, an undergraduate at Tufts, and I have to go up for my draft physical between my junior and senior year. That's an interesting thing to have to face. So you say, what are you going to do about the military at this point in time? So got the physical, and obviously you fly that, you pass that with flying colors. And it had a 7-year, at least we had a 7-year military obligation at that point in time. A couple of years or some time active duty, and then a period of time in the ready reserve. So it was a total of 7 years. So what do you do? Okay, I thought maybe it would be nice to be a naval aviator. So I went down to Naval Air Station in South Weymouth and took the air aptitude test. Failed it miserably. So what's your option now? No more glamour of going to, you know, flying the wild blue yonder. So, okay, next thing is Navy OCS Officer Candidate School to become a line officer, which I did, and I was accepted, and I went on active duty. Officer Candidate Seaman Apprentice, the 27th of July, 1959. Now, the bottom line of a little bit of this discussion is, you know, what do you do as a kid at that age? And you know, I really preferred a square meal and a bunk to sleep in than an M1 in a foxhole. Good Christian motivation to join the Navy. So, commissioned an ensign in the United States Naval Reserve, and I guess by act of Congress, I became an officer and a gentleman. And there we are. Now, again, just to go back to that undergraduate period again, in August of 57, the Soviets had launched the world's first ICBM, In October 57, Sputnik was launched, and thus began the race to space. 58, there was a flare-up in Lebanon, and the Marines landed and put things in order, and they left in October of 58. Now, while I was that undergraduate period of time when the Lebanon thing came along, we had a number of members of the fraternity living in the house who had come out of the Korean War. And these guys got notice from the government that be prepared to put your affairs in order because you may be going to Lebanon. So I was assigned to this little destroyer escort, DER, radar picket ship. And she was built by the Brown Shipbuilding Company. And we're going to hear a little bit more about this sleeping giant. Her keel was laid down in May of 43. She was launched in August of 43 and commissioned in November of 43. So from 6 months, in 6 months from the time the keel was laid until the time she was ready to go to sea, 6 months, not bad. Main propulsion was four Fairbanks Morse opposed piston diesel engines. And these were essentially railroad locomotive engines. Electric power came from three General Motors 268A diesels. She was twin screws, twin rudders. Did a fair amount of escort duty between the U.S. and the Mediterranean. In fact, did 8 round trips. There were 5-inch guns forward, 1 mount aft, 5 torpedoes midship, and depth charges on the fantail. That was the WW2 action. She got transferred to the Pacific in July of 45. Never made it because the war ended. She was decommissioned and then recommissioned in September of 55 in Newport, Rhode Island as a DER and a complement of 8 officers and 201 enlisted. Now that's the wartime complement. The peacetime allowance is something less and something different. Okay, what made her a radar picket ship? The original configuration was just that hull without this side here. So what that was done was this 01 level was extended out to the edge of the ship. This was enclosed. The second thing that was done, or the third thing, substituted 3-inch guns for the 5-inch guns forward and the other 3-inch gun aft, substituting for the aft 5-inch. There were hedgehogs added, which is this configuration up here. And the essence of the hedgehogs was that rather than rolling a depth charge off the fantail after you had passed over a submarine contact, with these hedgehogs you could launch forward like this as you were coming up and picking up the contact. Let me see what we can do.
There you go.
Okay, yeah, we get a little bit of reflection up there. That's why we did it that way. Okay. So, we got the hedgehogs. Oh, and the ECM capability, this array of stuff up here, allowed us to pick up a radio signal and analyze it down to the nth degree. But the key thing that separated us from the vast majority of DEs or DERs going to sea at that point in time was this height-finding radar back here. We have this air search up here, the old World War II bedspring type thing, and the surface search below it. We kept the hedgehogs on the fantail, and added also a water washdown system in the event of nuclear attack, so that you could hook that into the fire main and just become a big plume of water, and theoretically if anything happened it would all get washed away. Okay, now the dew line and where we fit into this whole thing. If you will, envision with me the North American continent. You got Alaska over here, across the top of Canada, the Maritimes, and over to Greenland. And there were fixed radar stations all across there. And now they were in place so to detect any Russian aircraft coming over the top of the world. And the Strategic Air Command was there as a retaliatory force should something nasty happen. Now, on the East Coast, what happened, and it was mirrored on the West Coast, was that we had land-based radars on Cape Cod. If you envision the Cape, and Truro is here, it was a land-based radar on that part of Truro, or on that part of the Cape. Quick digression there. My father was a roofing contractor in Lexington when I was a kid, and one of his prime customers was MIT Lincoln Lab. And they had a problem with these domed radar stations, and there would be a mini meteorological system on the inside of the dome. If you got the cold weather and the warm weather right, you get a rainstorm inside the dome. What they had elected to do when they put the domes on, they didn't put any stuffing tubes through there. So if it rained, the water dripped down onto the electronics, which was not cool. So we spent a fair amount of time down the Cape repairing those cableways and we put hot tar in them. So that was my exposure initially, which I didn't realize, to this whole dew line concept, which, by the way, was a brainchild of MIT, as a matter of fact. Beyond the land-based radar were the Texas Towers. That was the next step out. And they were, I think there was one on Georgia's Bank. Now, we'll have a little memory test here. TT-4, Texas Tower 4, sank with significant loss of life. Can anybody remember that? Okay. All right, good. Because I was thinking about that. I said, yeah, I think one of them went down. So I did a little research, and lo and behold, one of them did go down. Beyond the Texas Tower were World War II converted Liberty ships, and they were designated AGs. I can't quite remember what AG standard for. Another quick digression. Liberty ships. Back again to this awakened the sleeping giant. There were 2,710 Liberty ships built, strictly cargo vessels. They're merchant marine manned with a gun crew fore and aft, and there would be a JG or an ensign on board and a handful of, or two handfuls of enlisted men. They weigh 14,000 tons displacement, 441 feet long, 56 feet in the beam. Maximum speed, 11.5 knots. Engine was steam reciprocating engine. Imagine that. Single screw, single rudder. Now, they were Liberty ships, as probably most of us know, were a figment of Henry Kaiser, a rather significant one, and his shipyards on the West Coast, and I believe there were seven. In 1943, and again, back to the sleeping giant, they were turning out 3 Liberty ships per day. As you recall, it was a bow, a midsection, and a stern, and they welded them all together, and there you go. One of them, later named the Robert E. Perry, was launched in 4 days, 15.5 hours after her keel was laid. Now, granted, that was a PR stunt on the part of the then Roosevelt administration, but nevertheless a pretty significant piece of work in such a short period of time. Many of these Liberty ships were sold to, strangely enough, Greek shipping firms after World War II. And coincidentally, a number of them met their demise, courtesy of mines which had never been swept. So we have the Texas Towers and the Liberty ships, the AGs, were sitting on a station beyond the Texas Towers. Enter DERs. Yeah.
This is probably known, but it's a Liberty ship in San Francisco. If you were in San
Francisco,
at Fisherman's Wharf, it's a Liberty ship, and we learned all that.
Yeah.
It's fascinating to see it.
Yeah, it is. Yeah.
Walk through it, and next door is a World War II sub.
Yep.
But it's absolutely worth seeing.
Absolutely. So the next step out were DERs. And we ran a barrier with 4 stations between Argentia and Newfoundland to the Azores. So you'd steam and do a square for several days, go to the next stop, and somebody would relieve you all the way along. And about that time, when you got north of the Azores, then you'd sort of hot-foot it back to Newport and see if you could get a beer in the officers' club. There were 4 DERs in the division. As they say, we relieved one another. Now, beyond the DERs were naval aircraft flying way out there someplace. So we effectively now had the whole of the North Atlantic covered, from the coast of the United States almost to the coast of Europe by those several measures, all radar equipped. Now, the radar pickets and the ships that I were on continued to do that until 1965. But we received a very interesting new assignment, and we had a very sophisticated sonar installed. Now, the Navy, in its wisdom, and I cannot understand this, putting a sonar with a highly sensitive passive mode, could just listen to things happening. on a diesel-powered ship, which is probably the noisiest that ever lived. I mean, they are really noisy. So anyway, we Boston Naval Shipyard, in a dry dock number one, right next door to the USS Constitution. New sonar is installed. Down at Key West, and we did a evaluation of that sonar. And we could detect the torpedo tubes opening at a range of 12 miles. Now again, put it in perspective, the times it was, and this is 1960. But that was pretty good. Say again?
Who
made that? Edo. I think it was E-D-O, and they were on Long Island, as a matter of fact. Is that right?
That was while you were steaming, with all the noise in the back?
If you were listening passively, you pretty much were laid on, you know, no power on, just sat there and listened. But it was pretty formidable. Whilst we were tied up in Key West doing this evaluation, an interesting message came through, and it said, "Hostilities have broken out. Prepare to get underway." Interesting. And all the Navy guys know that one-third of the crew stays on board and two-thirds goes on the beach. Well, I was part of the one-third that was on board. So anyway, standard operating procedure was to light off the main engines and send some of the troops over on the beach to get a hold of the captain and the exec and as many officers and enlisted as could be found. And so we're standing on the fantail, and this is, you know, midnight to daybreak, looking north to Miami, expecting to see the great mushroom cloud come up. Fortunately, it never did. And then long again, about sunrise, another message came through and said words to the effect of, "We forgot to insert the words, this is a drill."
Oh.
All right. So we got through with the sonar evaluation and worrying about the mushroom cloud. And we were off to Scotland to operate out of Greenock, which is sort of south and west of Glasgow. And if you remember Holyoke, and there were nuclear submarines posted in there, and there was a lot of demonstrations vis-a-vis the nuclear aspect of things. So anyway, we're operating out of Greenock, and we're doing ASW patrol between the UK and Iceland, that body of water, to, you know, monitor Russian subs. Now, the interesting thing was that that sonar was not always operable. So many times we would just steam back and forth and do our thing. And we wound up harassing, shall we say, a number of Russian merchant vessels. We'd come alongside and wave, and they'd wave back at us, and we'd see, well, anyway. Interesting times. Enter the Cuban threat. Castro effectively became the man in January of 1959. And I think we need to keep in mind that Cuba is only 90 miles off the United States coast. So that was a significant threat. 61 was the Bay of Pigs fiasco, and the Berlin Wall went up. So our new assignment now was, because of this 8 Able radar, this height-finding radar, was to anchor off the coast of Cuba at a place called Dog Rocks. And we would sit there for 28, 30 days at a time, monitoring aircraft flying over. And if they were not within a prescribed altitude, call the Air Force in Miami, they'd scramble some fighters, and you'd watch the plot on the radar scope. Here's the fighters coming out like this, and the aircraft going like this, and you'd see a merged plot, and then they would separate. Every time, it was basically a commercial aircraft, which was either too low or too high, but the scrambling was kind of interesting. Some way, somehow, a lot of Cubans knew where we were anchored. And you could pick them up on the surface radar at about 12 miles. So we'd pick them up, and it would take them, the better part of at least a half a day to get from 12 miles out to get to our fantail. These vessels had about this much freeboard, maybe 30 or 40 feet long at the outside, and the sails were stitched together burlap bags. And they come alongside, tie up on the fantail, we bring them aboard, call the Coast Guard in Miami, and the Coast Guard would come up and pick them up and take them into Miami. Now, of course, we had a guard on the fantail at this time with, you know, two guys with shotguns. Of course, the shotguns weren't loaded. Yes, question?
What is a freeboard?
Oh, freeboard is the distance between the water here and the top of the gunwale, the top of the hull. So when you got that much freeboard on a 30 or 40 foot vessel, two more people and you know, sayonara. So we did that for a fair piece of time. Now, I've got to believe that some of those folks that we picked up on the Fantail and the Coast Guard came in and took them into Miami was the beginning of Little Havana in Miami. Has to be.
Sure.
Has to be. The missile crisis hit 27th of October, and you know Dan Fenn was our speaker back in December, and he was talking about what was going on in D.C. as far as dealing with that whole issue. We were anchored off the coast of Cuba, sort of a little bit on the front lines of all this thing. Anyway, the missile crisis occurred. The operations officer and I were scheduled to be released from active duty on the 31st of October that year, 1962. And just before we got back into Newport, there was a message that came through that your discharge date, officer and enlisted, if you had a discharge date of 1 November or thereafter, you were indefinitely extended. So John and I left the ship. She had a scheduled change of command and then got underway and was following Soviet vessels carrying missiles back to Russia. I got a letter from the engineering officer who relieved me, Rich Freeman. And Rich said, yep, we had a ballast for the first time, and it took us a better part of 30 days to track these guys or follow these guys back across the Atlantic. I will not attest to the sobriety of the operations officer and I after we left the ship and the ship sailed with everybody else indefinitely extended. That sort of takes care of the due line, a little bit about DERs, and as I guess I mentioned, that they also, there was a similar type operation on the West Coast to catch aircraft that might be coming, or missiles, from that part of the world, as well as coming from the East and going to the East Coast of the U.S. Any thoughts, questions on that due line and that due line experience? One sea story. We had a bosun mate, first class bosun mate. His name was Morris. And Morris was a classic old salt. They don't make him any saltier. And coupled with that, he had a little bit of a problem with alcohol. So Morris, when he got a new bunch of seamen aboard and they started to chip paint, he'd say, now don't come complaining to me. Don't come looking to me for sympathy. Because the only place you'll find sympathy in this vessel is in the dictionary, and it's between shit and syphilis. That's a bosun mate. That's a bosun mate. Yes?
Where does the name Dew come from? Is that
distant early warning.
What was the command structure or the operational structure that coordinated the Air Force's due line with the Navy's due line?
That is a very good question, and I really don't know the answer. What always struck me after the fact when I started putting together these pieces, starting when I was a kid working with my father, was nobody ever sat down with us, to the best of my knowledge, and explained the whole picture and what the command structure was. We were just this one little segment, and that's all we knew about, for better or worse. So I really don't know. I really don't know.
Were there any civilians aboard those airships?
No, strictly military. Now, I can tell you about it. I won't go into the sea stories about civilians being aboard, but no, not really, no.
On the West Coast, it was coordinated by the Air Force at McCord Air Force Base.
All right. So it could have been come out of here, west over maybe? Or what was the Pease?
Probably Rome, New York.
Okay, that could have been too. Rome?
Rome was the northeast corridor.
Okay, there you go. There's the answer. Super. All right, primer on mine warfare. It's called Mine Warfare 101. There are types of mines. We'll talk a little bit about the types of mines, mine countermeasures, and some statistics on the effectiveness of mines as a warfare item. Pretty effective, as a matter of fact. Released from active duty, served in a surface division for about a year. Surface divisions in those days, maybe it's the same today, I don't know. But it was like going to a Boy Scout troop meeting. You'd all muster, stand in a group like this, go through a very perfunctory inspection, and then go off to classes. Well, whoopee. Did that for about a year. Then bumped into a fraternity brother of mine. And Fred had command of the USS Turkey in Fall River. And I said, Fred, what the hell is a turkey? And he said, it's a minesweeper. I said, oh. And he said, why don't you come down and spend the weekend with us and see what it's like to go back to sea and what mine warfare is all about and minesweeping is all about. So I said, yeah, that sounds good to me. So I went down and never left. Went to sea one weekend a month and two weeks during the summer for the next 6 years. And ultimately wound up in command of the Turkey's relief, and then another minesweep, which we borrowed 1 year because one of the other, well, long story. Anyway, USS Turkey, MSCO 56. MSCO stands for Minesweeper Coastal Old. She started life as YMS 44, a yard minesweep. And she was built in 44 at Hildebrandt Dry Dock Company, Kingston, New York, which is just upriver from Poughkeepsie, as a matter of fact. 136 feet long, 35-foot beam, displaced 270 tons, twin screws, twin rudders. The propulsion engines were the same GMs that I had for generators on the DER, 500 horsepower each. She had seen service in the Pacific at the end of World War II, went back to the East Coast, and was named at that point, changed from YMS 444 to the USS Turkey. Now, MSCs are named after birds. So you had the reed bird, the siskin, and the falcon, among others. So there you go. Minesweepers Coastal were named after birds. She joined the reserve fleet in 1960 and was berthed at the Naval Reserve Training Center in Fall River. Now, there are other sweeps. There was one in Boston, one in Portsmouth, the one I had, which was in Fall River, and there was one over in Providence. So effectively, had we had a problem with mines, there were minesweeps in the key areas of the east, well, the northeast of the U.S. Narragansett Bay being of particular concern because that was destroyer headquarters on the East Coast. So that's what we were charged with. So basically, we'd go out 1 week of the month and go out on a Friday night, stay out all day Saturday, and come back in on Sunday. Yes?
Whose mines were you sweeping?
Well, actually, if you get down to cases, we were just playing at it. We streamed the gear so that we knew how to do what we had to do, but we never did really have to sweep any real mines.
You never found a mine?
Nope. That's good.
Dick, were they wooden boats?
Yeah. Yep. I should have mentioned that. Wooden, totally made of wood, and all the fittings, as far as possible, with the exception of the main engines, were either aluminum or brass or copper, non-magnetic all the way, to the point that the shoes or boots you wore, if you were out on deck dealing with the deck gear and so forth, the boots had aluminum plates in the toes. Oh. Not steel, but aluminum plates. Very, you know, critical that we be non-magnetic.
What was your maximum speed?
Oh, I think max we could crank out was about 12 knots. Yeah.
Can you imagine crossing the Atlantic with one of those?
No. Thank you, but no thank you. My roommate in college was on an MSO, which was an ocean-going minesweeper, which were about twice the size, and he made the transit a couple of times. Talk for a moment about the types of mines. There are two basic kinds of mines. The contact mine, which is the one you see in the movies, a great big sphere like this with the horns sticking out. You hit one of the horns, detonates the mine, hole in your hull, ship sinks. They'll put at various levels beneath the surface of the water. So you might have one down here, you might have one over here, you might have one at this level, and you might have some floating at the surface, or you might have some free-floating and not anchored to the bottom. So the trick then is to get the magnetic contact mine, cut it, bring it to the surface, and you detonated it with small arms fire. Keep in mind that while the sweeping operation is going on, everybody is on deck with a life jacket on, and that includes all the engineers from down below because you put the engines on remote operated from the bridge. Within the second type of mines, there are three kinds. The influence mines, contact mines, bang, hit it, up you go. Influence mines, three kinds, acoustic, magnetic, and pressure. And an acoustic mine is detonated by the sound of a ship's propeller. So what we did was tow behind us a thing called a hammer box. And the hammer box was nothing more than that, which was a thing with a diaphragm like this and a hammer on the inside, which went bup, 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 like that. The hope being that it would detonate a mine astern of you, ahead of you, to the port side or to the starboard side, but hopefully not underneath. But that dealt with the acoustic mine. Let's back up for just a sec, and I'll tell you about how you sweep.
Did they work?
Never had to, you know, they never had to do it for real. But I would assume that in a wartime condition, yeah, it did work. That's a word. Now, the other ramification of all this is with the influence type mines is you could set the mine so that it didn't go off when the first ship went over, but maybe didn't go off until the fifth one went over. Or the 8th, or the 10th. So that sort of compounds the felony. Another sort of truism with minesweeping is you can never completely sweep a minefield. Never can completely sweep a minefield. Let's drop back to a mechanical sweep. Minesweeper. This cable going here and here, the sweep cable, these are cutters. They're either mechanical or explosive. And this sort of looked like an overgrown pair of scissors. And when a cable from a mine would slide down into the business end, bang, it would go like this. And if it was mechanical, it would chop the cable, line floats to the surface, bang, you detonate it. Or they were explosive with a cartridge of some sort. And when it was triggered, bang, that would trigger the cutters and pop the mine. Now, to keep things down at the close to the ship was an item called the depressor, affectionately known as a kite. This was an otter at the other end of the sweep wire, and then this float pendant up here in the float. You've probably heard people talk about paravanes.
Yeah. So
that's it. That's a paravane. Affectionately known as a pig. So if you take that, gotta go back to this one. So if you have the gear out on both sides, that's what it looks like. 220 yards to that pig, 220 yards to the other side. And this is a pretty standard minesweep configuration. Interesting in confined waters to maneuver a ship with this gear out. Turns were made very slowly. Yeah?
What about the big separator? Why didn't you just put it behind the boat?
Because you needed the cutters on that.
Well, that's the way you cover the field.
The way you cover the field, yeah. Say again?
What held them apart as you pulled them forward?
The configuration of the sled and the otter. Okay? They were square things like this with vanes in them.
So that they were steered out.
Yep, that would throw it out on either side. But that was a standard single minesweep, you know, configuration. Now the next one, and this is the one that gets very interesting, is if you're a mechanical sweep, this is one you can do either to port or to starboard. But the key thing is you got minesweep 1, 2, and 3. 2 is keeping station on this guy's pig. 3 is keeping station on this guy's pig, so that there's overlap, so that you don't have a holiday and hope and theoretically miss a mine. So you have 1, 2, 3 ships sweeping. There's a fourth member of the team, and that was a sweep who would do lay dan buoys, and a dan buoy would mark the perimeter of the field which had been swept. Now dan buoys, for all intents and purposes, just envision a lobster buoy. Okay, only just make the staff on the lobster buoy about 6 feet tall and put a clump all the way to the bottom, a clump of concrete, and that would be a dan buoy. You could affix a blinking light for nighttime operations, and you could also affix the little radar reflector so that you could pick it up on radar. But you had a danning ship, which would be back here someplace, you know, theoretically out of harm's way, right? Because it's been swept and you got no holidays because you got the coverage.
You know, the enemy's put out a minefield.
Yep.
How do you know when you're dragging your gear, especially your dual, that there is a mine right in front of the sweeper?
Well, that, yeah, good point. I mean, that's, so you're driving the ship from the bridge, and hopefully if you do see something, you know, in front of you floating, you, you run the risk. Can never effectively sweep the whole
thing. Because it was a set-up field.
Yeah.
The first ship is in what is considered as areas free of the mines. So the first ship is doesn't have to think about running to the minefield, but those thereafter are the ones that clear the field.
There you go. The third type of influence mine are the ones that are activated by a magnetic field passing over them. So there was a special generator in the engine room, two cables that ran out, the short leg and the long leg, obviously. These broken lines were sticking down into the water. You got the water sort of here like this. And you towed, the long leg was 575 yards long. So that's what, almost 6 football fields long. So if you were maneuvering in confined waters with that particular configuration, and you had created this magnetic field that would detonate a magnetic sensitive mine, hopefully port, starboard, and behind you, there you go. But again, counters. It might go off the first time, might go off the 10th time. You never knew, never knew. Interesting, if you were maneuvering in confined waters, which we did upon occasion, going forward like this, make a turn, you could effectively be going this way in the vessel, and the tail would be going the other way because it was just following around in your wake. So it was kind of an interesting proposition. One of the, I guess, tests before you were allowed to command a sweep, at least in the southern waters of the United States, or the southern waters of Narragansett Bay, was to be out in Narragansett Bay on a Sunday afternoon in the summer with sailboat races with the tail streamed. And if you could significantly negotiate that whole thing, they gave you command. I got command. But this is hairy stuff. I didn't touch at all on pressure-sensitive mines because to the best of my knowledge and anything I've checked, there's no way that you can sweep for a pressure-sensitive mine. In other words, if there's a change in water pressure between where the mine is laid on the floor of the ocean and when a vessel goes over and the pressure changes, there's no way of effectively dealing with those to the best of my knowledge. So we almost sort of dismiss those. A little bit about laying mines. If you're, say, coming into Boston Harbor and the aggressor wanted to lay a minefield, he'd probably send some submarines in and they'd launch it through their torpedo tubes and launch basically the influence type mine, say, into Boston Harbor. If you were doing it on a defensive measure, probably it would be all contact mines. But you know where they were, so that then you know how to negotiate the minefield if you're an Allied vessel going in or out of the harbor. The effectiveness of mines and mine warfare, the mere threat or the rumor of a minefield is a deterrent in and of itself. You sure don't want to go into a harbor if you think it's moored, if it's mined. You just don't want to do it. So the threat is very important. For per ton of shipping sunk, mines are the most cost effective. Remember earlier I mentioned the destroyer escort by the name of the Samuel B. Roberts, the Sammy B. from the Battle of Leyte Gulf. Her namesake was the Samuel B. Roberts, which was an FFG, and she was struck by an Iranian contact mine, the big black things with the horns, during the Iraq-Iran War of 80-88. 10 sailors were wounded, and the cost of that contact mine was $1,500. It cost $96 million to repair the Roberts. So there you go with the effectiveness of mine warfare per ton of shipping or whatever, which is sunk. During the Gulf War, Iraqi naval mines damaged two vessels, the Princeton and the Tripoli. And the end of that particular war, 8 countries conducted mine clearing operations to do the best they could with getting the mines out of there. Nearly 80% of United States ship casualties since 1950 have involved mines employed by an inferior navy. Okay. The other 20% came from missiles, torpedoes, or aerial attack. World War I, just to go back a little bit in history, the Brits mined the 250-mile northern entrance to the North Sea. That's from Scotland to Norway. They laid 56,000 mines, and they sunk 22 U-boats. And guess who was first Lord of the Admiralty? Winston Churchill. Mine hunting is another thing that we did, but not to any great extent. And I think that became more the vogue as sonar gear became more sophisticated. But you could effectively, with a good sonar, active sonar, detect a mine laying out there someplace and then take measures to detonate it one way or another. Sweeping in latter days was also done via helicopter. And then back to wooden hulled boats, iron men and wooden ships.
Do they still worry about it?
I'm going to say yes. When I was on active duty and we would go through the Irish Sea heading up to Glasgow, we were on the lookout. Now, this is, 15 years after World War II, but we effectively still look for black contact mines floating loose.
Yeah, they're designing underwater robot.
Yep. As a matter of fact, I came across this. This little thing right here, which is a remote-operated mine warfare instrument. I don't know how it works. I just came across it and said, oh, that's interesting. Now, whether it's towed by a helicopter, towed by a vessel, I don't know. But there you go. This is probably the newest and the latest. They effectively, let's put it this way. Basic premise, you can't completely sweep a field. To the best of my knowledge, yeah, they got them all out because they knew where they were. That's a key thing. If you're laying a minefield, you know where they are.
By detonating them or physically removing?
By detonating. I'm sure they snipped them, swept them, Bob comes up, bang, that's it. But 56,000 mines is a lot of mines. Yes?
I was involved in the cleaning up of the minefield down in Trinidad. They laid 1,100 mines, and we were able to get 100.
There you go. 10%. 10%.
Where did they figure all the others were? Still not found?
Well, they become deteriorate, yep. One thing. The mine itself is only half full, and the mine, has a leak in it,
yep.
And therefore it'll sink. Sometimes they will break away from their mooring and drift around and then finally go to the bottom. But many of those areas still have on the map that concerns need to be considered as far as the fact that there was a mine field there and to be, if possible, to be conscious of it.
If my memory serves me correctly, too, with some of the influence type mines, after they'd been down there for X period of time, they sort of self-destructed, not blew up, but sunk or wherever, were neutralized. But that was over a period of time.
Well, they did that in the Pacific,
yep.
Where they would put the mines in, and they didn't want to have the mines there when they invaded
right.
The island. So they would put this destruct mechanism right. On, and therefore it would be...
Wouldn't be a hazard when you made the invasion. Yeah. Yep. Well, there.
In the first Gulf War, we were told that a significant portion of the floating mines that Iraq loosed into the Gulf were contact mines, which they'd gotten from Russia, but they were Russian imperial mines circa 1904. And it made me wonder whether those were the mines that hit the Tripoli and Nassau.
Could very well be. There is a memorial on the Boston Common to the mine forces of World War I. And it's up that little knoll that overlooks the Frog Pond. And there's a contact mine up there and then the clump, the anchor below it. You know, here's the clump and here's the mine. But it's kind of an interesting spot to see periodically. if you've been down to the sea in ships, I guess. Have a good friend who came up with this photograph. So, from World War II, 1945, March thereof. Can you identify the players? Okay. Whoop. There's Patton. Brad's right there. Eisenhower. And that was General Hodges. I can't think of his first name. Fifth Army, I do believe. But look at the DC-3 behind it, the C-47, whatever the designation was. But boy, does that have a Patton, right?
Yeah.
Wow. Another little quickie here. If you're a native Lexingtonian, tell me what church that is. That's St. Bridget's. Yeah, that's St. Bridget's, the first St. Bridget's. My wife Ashley has done a number of books dealing with postcards, or the history through postcards. That was one we came up with as far as postcards about Lexington, but that's the old St. Bridget's.
Sold for a million?
I think probably you're right. Yeah, I think probably you're right. And another postcard that we came up with is, if you want to identify that one, and where does that stand on the green?
On the corner.
Monroe, next to the Congregational Church, next to Hancock. That's the Wirtz's house. Yep.
Oh.
Yep.
Yeah, it is.
Yep. So if you're interested in a great history of Lexington and Concord and Bedford, Ashley has a book about the whole thing. It's done through postcards. Very interesting.
I was in Vermont, and I was visiting a family, and the gentleman was a couple of years older than I was, but he had a copy of the proceedings of the Naval Institute, and I got so fascinated with in reading that, came back to the library and I realized we didn't have it, so I funded it for a year, 3 years. So if anybody was interested in seeing the proceedings, under P, you know, it's kind of on the bottom row.
Yeah.
But it's hard, it might be hard to find, but it's very interesting reading.
Yeah,
it's
I'm sure.
Magazine. Very good reading.
One I didn't put up, but let me just. There's four minesweepers operating a line abreast. Yeah, we had a problem with the projection, and you know we either lose the reflection or we lose the ship. We're about 250 yards apart, and when you're riding the pig up in front of you, you're about 25 yards off the pig. So it's kind of an interesting exercise in seamanship.
What happens if a ship ahead of you cuts a mine loose in the next?
Hopefully you can detonate your, hopefully your sharpshooters are better than theirs. On the front of a sweep was a some millimeter machine gun, plus a lot of the engine men that came out of the engine rooms would be up there with their M1s or what have you. And, if it came to it. Yeah. Yes?
I think you realize that only the staggered columns, which they use in cleaning the fields, that when someone in front of you cuts a mine, it's really going down your side because it's to the, depending upon if it's the left or right hand pattern, that when the mine comes up, I've seen it happen, but it just drifts by. You won't have to watch it bounce by you, so forth.
Another question.
Yeah, I noticed in the photos the sails are calm. If it's choppy or pretty bad, what happens then? You just don't sweep?
That was our approach to it. Now, I can't speak for, you know, actual going after mines for the real thing, so my friend, maybe he can address that question.
Well, I think one of the things that tends to happen is that you're sweeping generally in a more sheltered area.
Yeah.
Not when you're going from point to point, but in a more sheltered area. And if it is rough, you call it off for that time period.
Right.
mentioned the Dry Dock 1, I guess. Is that the one that Catherine Young is in today?
She's not in it. She's adjacent to it, I think. I recall the pier. You got the pier, the Constitution, Catherine Young, and Dry Dock number 1's over here, as I recall.
Granite Dry Dock?
It's the oldest one they got, so I'm going to assume it's. I've been in there 3 times. And
That was built by Lamy Baldwin, Jr.,
okay.
The son of the guy who built the Middlesex Canal.
Okay, really?
And,
yeah. Makes sense.
The model for it just turned up, and we'll probably have it up in the Middlesex Canal Museum.
Oh, that's great.
Maybe sometime this fall.
That's great. Yeah.
Also, the model of the caisson that's used to seal the thing off.
Yeah.
We may have that too.
Wonderful. Wonderful. Yes?
What kind of threats are there in today's world for which a Navy is the most effective response, and what kind and size of a Navy?
That's a very good question. I'm not sure that I'm capable of answering it, but I guess I would say this, that the standard, and I think there's still the standard configuration of a Navy task group is a carrier preceded by a screen of destroyers with a cruiser between the cruiser between the screen of destroyers and the carrier, and then you get one or two cans after the carrier. And that mobile configuration, I'm going to assume, is still a major thing.
What are they going to confront?
Other aircraft coming in and missiles coming in. Had a conversation some years back with a guy who was the captain of an Aegis-class guided missile cruiser, and we got to talking about things. And I said, "What's your reason for being?" And he said, "We're here to intercept missiles that come in for the carrier." And I said, "What about any submarine?" And he said, "No, that's the destroyers out in front. That's their job. We're strictly here to deal with the missiles." And his last line of defense for a missile coming in was an old-fashioned Gatling gun. You know, there you are. Yeah, quite a new model, but same principle. Yes?
Hey, I've heard something about the Navy using dolphins to find mines. Do you know anything about that?
I've heard the same thing, but I know nothing beyond that I've heard it. Yes?
Useless tidbit of information. During World War II, the Jersey-class battleships carried 2 sleds.
Is that right?
Yes.
Yeah. Because you'll see pictures of WW2 naval vessels with a pair of paravanes on the fantail. Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Yes?
In fact, I think I'm not wrong that the King Mutiny, that the ship that Queen was the captain of, was a ocean minesweeper.
Could be. I can't remember. No, the human interaction side of the thing, but I can't recall what kind of a vessel it was. Palm tree went over the side. Didn't it? No, that's Mr. Roberts. Okay. Thank you very much. It's been a pleasure to be here.
Thank you, Peter. Very much.